the late spring of 1968, Al Kooper called Mike Bloomfield with a proposal for a session he wanted to do. Kooper had quit his group, Blood, Sweat, and Tears, and was working as a producer for Columbia Records. Kooper wanted Michael to join him in the studio for an impromptu jam session, much as they had done with Moby Grape back in March.
When we made Super Session, we had no idea that it would be as popular as it was. I mean, one of the concepts of the record was to make a record based on the plethora of jazz albums that had that as a concept, which just put so-and-so, so-and-so, so-and-so in a room and recorded them. And the reason they did it is because so-and-so, so-and-so, and so-and-so had never played together before on a record. And they were really, you know, to major extents, jam sessions. So I said, wow, let's do that with rock and roll. It's a valid art form.
On May 28, Mike Bloomfield joined Al Kooper, Harvey Brooks, and Eddie Ho in Los Angeles to jam. The atmosphere was relaxed, and Michael seemed at ease. They started out with a couple of blues featuring Bloomfield's guitar, and for the first time in the studio, Michael's sound was truly captured. When it was all over, they had five tunes completed, including a Curtis Mayfield soul cover and a jazzy 6/8 time modal piece. Kooper drove the musicians back to the rented mansion where they were to spend the night. They would complete the session in the morning. But when morning arrived, Bloomfield was nowhere to be seen. A confused Kooper found a note on Michael's bed.
In the case of the first Super Session, I think he just couldn't score in Los Angeles there. I think he therefore he could not sleep. And he went, he just went nuts. He said, fuck this. And made phone calls over the course of the evening until he got himself out of there.
The guitarist, once again suffering from insomnia, had simply gone back to San Francisco, where he could sleep better. Kooper later speculated that Michael may have been trying unsuccessfully to make a drug connection, and had decided he'd have better luck back in San Francisco. Whatever the reason, Bloomfield was gone. Kooper hastily secured the services of former Buffalo Springfield guitarist Steve Stills to complete the session. Back home in Mill Valley, Mike Bloomfield set to work extricating himself from the electric flag. He had contractual obligations to sort out with Grossman and financial accounts to settle. He also had one more gig to play. The flag was scheduled to perform for Bill Graham at the Impresario's new performance space, the Fillmore East. The band flew to New York and opened a two-night stand at the city's premier rock palace on Friday, June 8th. By now, everyone knew it would be Bloomfield's last performance with the flag.
Here's the incredible electric flag.
By all accounts, the electric flag turned in a stellar performance.
Yeah!
The old fire was there, right, even if only for one last time. The New York Times reviewed one of the flag shows, noting that the band's final appearance was a crossroads event. For Michael Bloomfield, it truly was a turning point. Never again would he lead an organized band, an industry supergroup, and no longer would he play the role of guitar god. Instead, he would retire to Mill Valley, kick his drug habit, and get his life back together. Music would have to take a back seat. But fate had something else in mind for Mike Bloomfield. Toward the end of August, Columbia released the date with Al Kooper. The album was given the prophetic title, Super Session. To the surprise of all involved, Super Session climbed the charts, eventually reaching the number 13 position in December. Realizing that it had a hit record on its hands, Columbia promoted the album heavily. Al Kooper, realizing his first production effort was a runaway success, decided he needed to capitalize on the super session concept. Mike Bloomfield, thrust into the spotlight once again, was appalled. Bloomfield had spent the better part of a year working on the Electric Flags album, only to have it go nowhere on the charts. Now a session with little or no thought behind it was being acclaimed as a commercial and artistic triumph. He thought Super Session was nothing but a scam.
I think that Kooper had a good idea by calling something Super. Superstar, Super this, that he could sell records. On the Super Session album, I don't think I was there more than 6 hours. I came in, played one side of a record, and went home. But basically what it was selling a product by its name, not really by the content. Or the content, not really the musical content, but more the idea of some people getting together to jam in an informal way, and that was the premise that was going to make the record sellable. And I think in a great many ways that's what it did. And that's why I call it a scam.
But for Kooper, it was a golden opportunity. Al arranged for Super Session to appear at Bill Graham's new venue in San Francisco. Michael reluctantly agreed. The jam band was to perform at the Carousel Ballroom, newly christened the Fillmore West by Bill Graham, on the last weekend in September. The week before the gig, Kooper and Bloomfield spent 4 days frantically rehearsing. On opening night, a nervous Bloomfield gave one of his characteristic speeches.
1-2, 1-2. Listen here. Now here's what, this is where it's at. This is the thing of this gig, and here I'll tell you about it now. A while ago, Alan Kooper, my friend, called me on the phone and said, let's make this gig an LP in Los Angeles, and we'll jam together and we'll see what will happen. So we went and I played for 1 day with Alan in the studio, and I split and went back to San Francisco where I live. And the other day, Stephen Stills played, and they put out an album called Super Session. And so it's half a session, you know, half a session because we're going to jam because, you know, what the hell, how much do we know? And the other half is numbers, but I want you to know, like, this is the truth of where we're playing, so now you know where it's at. Okay.
Despite his exhausted state, Bloomfield turned in some stunning performances. But after only 2 nights, Michael collapsed and was hospitalized. With his star guitarist again incapacitated, Kooper found replacements in Steve Miller, Elvin Bishop, and a young Carlos Santana. Super Session became a true jam session. The concert's various performances were issued by Columbia in February 1969. The album was aptly entitled The Live Adventures of Mike Bloomfield and Al Kooper. Adventures indeed. The double record release's distinctive cover was painted by the famed American illustrator Norman Rockwell. One of the executives at Columbia knew Rockwell, and Kooper persuaded him to have the painter create a portrait of the two musicians, the blues singers, as Norman called them. Live Adventures wasn't as successful as Super Session, but it still sold very well. Jam-style records were seen as the next big thing in rock, and Mike Bloomfield was heralded as one of the top guitarists in the new genre. But now Michael Bloomfield had had enough. Enough of the hype, enough of the drugs, the egos, the partying, the groupies, enough of the business, enough of everything that had nothing to do with music. In 5 short years, a kid from Chicago's suburbs with a love of the blues had gone from sitting in with Muddy Waters and Howlin' Wolf to recording for the legendary John Hammond, creating folk rock with Bob Dylan, sparking the groundbreaking Paul Butterfield Blues Band, inventing the brass rock sound with his own band, and scoring a top hit solely on his skill as a guitarist. Michael Bloomfield had achieved more by age 25 than most musicians do in a lifetime. He had been America's first blues rock guitar virtuoso, an innovator and promoter of the music he loved. But now it was time for something different. Michael bought a home on Carmelita Avenue in Mill Valley. He shared it with his friends, his books and records, and his two dogs. He would play music on his own terms, whenever he wished, content to play the role of an elder master of the blues rock idiom. But without question, Michael Bloomfield had made major contributions to American popular music. The effects of his innovations would be felt for decades to come. He was America's first true guitar hero.